Hey guys, how's it going? And oh my god, we're finally here. I have been waiting to make this video for so long. But I have zero attention span, so I can't finish books anymore. Only when I made the goal of making this video and began reading with that in mind was I able to finish it finally. And it was awesome. I honestly don't even know how to talk about it because, to be honest, I am speechless. But before that, if you haven't already, then please subscribe and hit the bell. Also, I stream my art on Twitch and now sometimes I'm on YouTube. Timing and schedule are still in the works, so make sure to follow me on Twitter so you get the latest updates. All the links are in the description. So, The Night Circus. I first learned of this book when someone on Instagram messaged me and said I should read it and make some art based on it. And you'll see in a moment why they said this. The title itself seems so strange to me that I was instantly drawn to it. So I googled it and after a little bit of research, bought the book. Because books are expensive, you know. You can't just buy them willy-nilly and you may or may not end up liking it. And I am not one of those people who can resell it. I get attached to my stuff. This book is written by Erin Morgenstern over the span of 3 National Novel Writing Month competitions. I just added that because I find it a really interesting fact. The genre is fantasy and the book deals with magic and magicians and of course the central element, the night circus. Let me read you the back of the book first to give you an idea of what the circus is like. By the way, it's been a long time since I saw a book that actually has the summary at the back rather than pointless reviews. Anyway, so it says, what kind of circus is only open at night? The circus arrives without warning. It is simply there, when yesterday it was not. Against the grey sky, the towering tents are striped black and white. A sign hanging upon iron gates reads, opens at nightfall, closes at dawn. As dusk shifts to twilight, tiny lights begin to flicker all over the tent, as though the whole circus is covered in fireflies. When the tents are aglow, sparkling against the night sky, a sign lights up. The Cirque du Rêve, the circus of dreams. The gates shudder and unlock, seemingly by their own volition. They swing outward, inviting the crowd inside. Now the circus is open. Now you may enter. So that was the text on the back of the book. Now this circus, which only opens at night and closes at dawn, quickly begins succeeding due to its whimsical nature. The aesthetic of this circus is described in extreme detail. And this is what really impressed my visual brain. Morgenstern describes the decoration, the clothes people wear, the elements of the circus in such beautiful detail. You can picture the thing like a movie in your head. And not just like a blurry mental image. Everything is so incredibly clear. There is no doubt. She will make you see exactly what she wants. And the aesthetic that she has set for this novel is so beautiful. Most of the things are black and white, with occasional pops of red. Now you see why I was recommended this book? The circus tents have black and white stripes. Everything in the perimeter of the place is black and white, even down to the ground on which it's situated. The concepts of the magical stunts performed are also explained in extreme detail, and they are really unique concepts too, not just your standard spell casting, levitating, etc. It's set in an ahistorical Victorian era. So, we have ladies wearing beautiful gowns that are also described in detail down to the prints on it. I specifically like this one excerpt, so I am going to read you that paragraph from it. A moment later, Celia Bowen is sitting in front of him, turned to the side and resting her arms on the back of the chair. She is dressed as she had been during her performance, in a white gown, covered in a pattern of unassembled puzzle pieces, falling together into darkness along the hem. I mean, can you not just picture that? And this dress is so pretty. Puzzle pieces, stripes, these are all things that invoke a sense of mystery. A bunch of puzzle pieces, and that too unassembled, give out a sense of mystery, like we cannot see the full picture yet. Just like that, stripes are usually associated with the odd ones out, the weird and the enigmatic. Someone who does not fit into the status quo, or for better or for worse. And all these things aid in forming a big picture that evokes a sense of wonder magic, and not only piques our curiosity but constantly keeps it up. The choice of the location being the circus is a big influence here, because in a circus we always see things we wouldn't see in our daily lives. People who can do things you have never even imagined of doing. And whether magical or not, a circus is always a place of wonder. I think a lot of us have been to a circus as kids, and when reading this book, you can channel back to the feeling you had when you first saw it. That's how it felt to me. And in this way, it gives you a sense of nostalgia as well, even though it's not based in reality. Okay, so the location is the circus, but you're wondering for what? And this brings us to the actual premise of the story and the two main characters. I started reading this book like 2 years ago and stopped for several months in between, because like I said, I don't have any attention span anymore. So I don't have the details down to a T, but to paraphrase, the book begins with a powerful magician called Prospero the Enchanter, finding out he has a daughter who is then sent to him after the mother has passed away. He also finds out that this girl has inherited his magical powers, and as such, he decides to teach her to hone in on her skill. He is soon visited by a mysterious Mr. A.H., who is also a very powerful magician, not unlike Prospero himself, and the two challenge each other to teach one candidate of their choice everything they know and then pit them against each other in a magical challenge that goes on until a winner is declared. Prospero, or Hector Bowen, as his real name is, chooses his own daughter Celia Bowen, while Mr. A.H. picks up a talented boy from an orphanage named Marco Alistair. And these two, Celia and Marco, are the two main characters of this book that are pitted in a magical duel that lasts for about a decade on the grounds of the Night Circus. There are a flurry of other characters, each one very unique and interesting in their own right. There's the owner of the circus, Chandresh, who is as eccentric as a person gets. He tries to outdo himself with stranger and stranger endeavors, the Night Circus being his biggest one yet. And when he's not doing that, he holds dinners that begin at midnight. Then there's the clockmaker, Friedrich Thiessen, who unintentionally creates a fandom for the circus who calls themselves Reviews, aka Dreamers. There's Bailey, who is just a simple fan of the circus until he decides to sneak into it during daytime. And there's a set of red-haired twins born on the same day as the circus opening, Poppet and Widget, who have the ability to see the future and the past respectively. There are many, many more such interesting characters, and they're all so unique that one cannot overshadow the other. The story is told in a non-linear fashion, and honestly, sometimes it annoyed me when the previous chapter ended on a cliffhanger. Pretty much all of them do, but some were more unbearable than the other. Regarding the main plot, I don't remember where I read this, but before beginning this book, I read that it's about star-crossed lovers, and I latched onto the idea. That term is kind of a spoiler, because as soon as you hear star-crossed lover, you have a very specific vision in your head for where the story is going. Basically, if you don't know, star-crossed lover is two people who love each other a lot, but their relationship is doomed to fail. Mostly this means that they are going to end up dying. However, the ending that we actually do get in this book is a lot more than the simple definition that I just told you. So I was expecting that, and as soon as I got to the point where Marco meets a girl, I assumed that it's Celia. Even though her name is Isobel, her appearance is different than Celia. She and her are in different countries at the same time, but I'm like, this is Celia in disguise. I bet she is using her magic. So I spent half the book highly convinced that they are the same people, and they're not. I'll save you the confusion. They are not. They are entirely different women, and maybe I'm the only one dumb enough to think that. If you've read the book, let me know. So it's obvious that I'm obsessed with this book. But there's a couple of things I didn't like, and at least one of them is most likely my own fault. I skipped reading the date and location on top of each chapter, so sometimes I got whiplash from the time skip in the story. The way the story was written didn't indicate any passage of time. It was just through the characters talking, and every time they mentioned it, I was shocked because I was not prepared for it and like halfway into the chapter. And the second thing I didn't like is the decision to write in present tense. That is my least favorite form of narration ever. I don't know why anyone would pick that. It's quite annoying, honestly. I initially didn't know why it bugs me so much, but then I thought about it some more and I figured it out. This might just all sound really weird, but if you're on this channel, you should prepare yourself for that. So when I hear a sentence say, she walks in, takes a seat opposite him and starts talking, it comes off as role play to me. My brain just adds an extra imagine at the end of it. Like, imagine that she walks in, takes a seat opposite him and starts talking. And that in turn tells me that I am just supposed to imagine all of it. It's only in my head and never actually happened. That breaks my immersion in the story. When stories are written in past tense, like she walked in, took a seat opposite him and started talking, that has a certain surety to it. Like, yeah, those things happened at some point in time and space, and now the author is telling me about it. It's a lot easier to suspend my disbelief and immerse myself in the story at that point. Please tell me if this makes sense to someone. But I'll end on a positive note. I'd like to read one of my favorite passages of the book that come towards the end and is very inspiring for any budding writers. So if you're someone who is scared to share your story, this is for you. It is important. The man in the gray suit interrupts. Someone needs to tell those tales. When the battles are fought and won and lost, when the pirates find their treasures and the dragons eat their host for breakfast with a nice cup of lapsang souchong, someone needs to tell their bits of overlapping narrative. There's magic in that. It's in the listener. And for each and every ear, it will be different. And it will affect them in ways they can never predict. From the mundane to the profound, you may tell a tale that takes up residence in someone's soul, becomes their blood and self and purpose. That tale will move them and drive them, and who knows what they do because of it, because of your words. That is your role, your gift. Your system may be able to see the future, but you yourself can shape it. Do not forget that. There are many kinds of magic after all. So this was something Mr. A.H. was talking to Bridget, who writes stories. And I just think that it's really important for everyone to hear. And honestly, this right here sums up my feelings for this book. This book has definitely left its mark, and it's going to be in my all-time favorites. Something I will keep thinking about and talking about. So this was my review of The Night Circus. Highly, highly recommend this book. Have you read The Night Circus? Are you going to read this after watching this video? Are there any similar books I should check out? Say all of that in the comments. I'm eager to hear from you. See you next time. Bye.